Good morning, Harmony Grove. Hey, if you're in the back, come in and join us. Pick up a bulletin. Have all the announcements in our church. Just want to highlight two things as we begin. Wednesday night, we do have kids programs. We do have prayer meeting. This Wednesday night is our last kids program of the year. I know, sad. If you are in Awana, there is a closing program. Parents, you are invited to come out and watch that. There's also the annual kickball game afterwards. So we do need a couple of parents to help out with that. And again, that is Wednesday night at 7 p.m. Our final announcement this morning is about Vacation Bible School. We are almost up to 20 kids registered so far, which is great. That's a great start. That's not a great ending. So with a little bit over a month to go, please be passing out cards. Please be liking and sharing it on social media to help us get the word out. If you go out of the sanctuary, you'll see the Twister game on your right. And on the Twister game are little post-its of items we need for Vacation Bible School. So if you're thinking, how can I help and you're not able to volunteer, this would be a great way to help. You can take that with you, put it on your grocery list, go and get the water balloons or plates or whatever your card says. And we would like those things back by Father's Day. So if you could make sure they're here a week before we can get them to the people who need them, that would be great. All the other announcements are in your bulletin. Going to have Charlotte come pray, and we're going to begin singing in a moment.
Let us pray. Dear Jesus, we thank you so much for the opportunity that we have to come and learn and worship this morning. We know that this is a privilege for us that many around the world don't have. And Lord, we pray that you will open our hearts this morning, that you will show us how to share grace with those around us this week, our neighbors, people who come across our path. Let us show them the grace that you would have us to extend. And Lord, I pray that this worship time will be blessed this morning, and that we will hear from your word what you would have us to hear today. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Please stand as you are able as we begin in worship.
Let go of every single tree.
I need your rest.
My knee
Lord. So awesome.
Okay, if you want, turn in your Bibles to 2 Timothy chapter 3 for a scripture reading. I'll be reading verses 1 through 9, page 690 in the Pew Bibles, if you want to follow along there. 2 Timothy 3, 1 through 9. But know this, that in the last days perilous times will come. For men will be lovers of themselves, lovers of money, boasters, proud, blasphemers, disobedient to parents, unthankful, unholy, unloving, unforgiving, slanderers, without self-control, brutal, despisers of good, traitors, headstrong, haughty, lovers of pleasure rather than lovers of God, having a form of godliness but denying its power. And from such people turn away. For this sort are those who creep into households and make captives of gullible women, loaded down with sins, led away by various lusts, always learning and never able to come to the knowledge of the truth. Now as Jannes and Jambres resisted Moses, so do these also resist the truth. Men of corrupt minds disapprove concerning the faith, but they will progress no further, for there is folly will be manifest to all, as theirs also was. God bless his word.
Please stand as you are able as we continue in worship this morning.
Thank you.
worship team. It was awesome having Aiden join us this morning. Thank you, my friend. I want to give a special thank you to our worship team. You see the front row. I get to serve in the back row. Ken is a great guitarist, and I keep telling him, play a little louder. You're playing some really cool stuff. Often I just get to listen to what they're playing. I love listening to Kurt on the bass because we'll practice it one way and it sounds good. And then when you hear it Sunday morning, he pulls out the very special fills and he'll get a little bit of a run there. I go, oh, I did not hear that one earlier. That one was nice. I appreciate that. Main reason to thank the worship team is because every once in a while the pastor gives them a crazy request. Hey, can you learn this new hymn? This would help me in my message. Nod your head. Have you ever heard that old hymn this morning? I love the refrain. A couple of you saying yes. A bunch of you have blank stares. You may have this world, but give me Jesus. Some of you like the history of these hymns. Most times you'll find this hymn, the author is unknown. It was first published by Jacob Knopp in 1845. He was a preacher in the Catskills in New York. And after releasing this hymn in 1845, it kind of suffered in modern obscurity. Never really caught on, wasn't really well known. It was re-released in 1867. 2 years after the Civil War, in a hymnal titled Slave Songs of the United States. And it was in that hymnal it rose to great popularity, as you can see and hear from the words. Abolitionist Frederick Douglass said this about that hymnal, that these songs breathe the prayers and complaint of soul suffering, the most cruel anguish. Each voice was a witness against slavery and a prayer that God would deliver us from our chains. I often found myself in tears listening to them. In other words, that these were the songs of hope when the world seemed awfully hopeless. You may have this world, but give me Jesus. We're going to talk about our hope in this world a little bit this morning. The question to you is your hope in Jesus this morning. So let's take a moment and pray, and we'll go through our Bible study together. Father, this is your time, and this is your scripture. And Father, I just help as your messenger just to get it right. Lord, that as we see the craziness of our world, may we find hope in you, Lord Jesus. That you formed us and that you made us, and Father, you are with us. And while it seems like out there just going from bad to worse, people are deceiving and being deceived, God, allow us to know that there is a better plan and a better way through your Son, Jesus. So give us your strength, we ask, in Christ's name, amen. If you have your bulletin, we do have 3 points as we go through our Bible passage this morning. Thanks for reading that for us. Verse 1, chapter 3 begins, "We know this, that in the last days, perilous, dangerous, horrible, no good, bad days will come." 2 Timothy is Paul's last words, his last letter, written just a couple weeks, maybe a few months before he dies. And what he's doing is he's encouraging his young protege, Timothy. And what he's doing is he's kind of going back and going through some of the lessons they talked about in the first letter. So if you're following along, in the first letter, 4:1, he says, "Now, the Spirit explicitly says that in latter days, some will depart from the faith, giving heed to deceiving spirits, doctrine of demons." That in last days and in the final days, these will be horrible, wicked, no good, bad days. If you read through the Bible, many people talk about the last days, the things that are going to come. In fact, Jesus mentions it towards the end of his life in Matthew 24. He says, many will come saying, I'm the Christ. It will lead many astray. You will hear of wars, rumors of wars. You'll see that you are not alarmed. But this may take place. But the end is not yet. For nation will rise up against nation, kingdom against kingdom. Be famines, earthquakes in various places. All these are the beginning of birth pains. So when Jesus talks about the last days, he talks about the physical things that might happen. He gives the illusion to birth pains. We've all seen in the movies the lady, her water breaks and the show is about to happen. And for those of you who've been a part of it, I'm not an expert in this, but bear with me a moment. But the contractions start off every 8 minutes, every 7 minutes, every 6 minutes, and they get closer and closer to when the show happens, when the birth is about to take place. And Jesus is saying that towards the end, you're going to see these signs. You're going to see wars, and you're going to see famines, and you're going to see earthquakes. You're going to have these natural disasters, and we know we're getting it close to the end. By the way, you look at the crazy world around us. A lot of craziness out there, right? Jesus talks about the physical. Paul here talks about the spiritual. That you'll know the end days are about to happen, not just with the famines and the earthquakes, but look at the heart of men. Men will be lovers of themselves. Nod your head if you've found this to be true in the world around us. And by the way, this is just the opposite of what God says. We're going to do a couple things. You know, this is the most important commandment. The love of the Lord our God with all of our heart, with all of our soul and all of our mind and all of our strength. And the second commandment is like it, to love our neighbors. We love ourselves. This is the sign of godliness. But in the last days, instead of, you know, people becoming more and more like Christ, they're going to be lovers of themselves. Some of you remember a time where our society was known of people who were good neighbors, that we cared, that we looked out for one another. And now it seems the longer we go, people are simply looking out for themselves. This is the first one. This is the kind of the summary of this entire list. Now, I know some of you, I believe there's two types of people. There are people who are list people and people who are not list people. Nod your head if you're a list person. I'm a list person. Every week, this is how I start my week. I write a list of everything I need to do. I just lay them all out. And then you'll see some of them are circled because those are like the top three I want to get through that day. It's a good day if I get through my top three things on my list. Now, granted, some days a phone call will happen and this list goes out the window and, you know, life happens. And someday you might even scratch off four or five. But I'm a list person. If I have a day off and she doesn't have to give me my honey to-do list, I'll write out 10 or 15 things myself and go, okay, these are the things around the house that needs to be done. I need to do this. I need to do this. And for me, there's a certain satisfaction by crossing off something off their list. Some of you are like, some of you look at this and go, oh my goodness, that is overwhelming. For those of us who've been through college or you have kids in college, there's a day in college, the first day of the year, it's called syllabus day. When you go to your classes and they just give you a list, it's called a syllabus. It's 4 or 5 pages. This is everything you got to do this semester to pass this class. Your first day of college, you go to 3, 4, 5 classes, and you get nothing but syllabuses, nothing but lists of books to read and papers to write. And you know what it is? It's a little overwhelming. Some of you are like, oh, I get to put all this stuff down. I know when all my tests are. And some of you are like, I don't know how I'm getting through this semester. Why do I bring this up? If you're reading through this text here, the rest of this paragraph from verse 2 all the way down through verse 5 is a list. It is 19 things describe the things of this world. And when you read through this list, you're like, this is a little overwhelming. Again, this is the heart of our society, right? Lovers of self. Some words you might not even know what they mean. Blasphemers, people who are slanderers and brutal and all these other things. And if we're going to take a big picture look of it, it reminds us of this. It reminds us of these terrible days that are to come. People will be lovers of the self, lovers of money, boastful, proud, blasphemies, disobedient to parents, unthankful, unholy. Some of your parents are like, yes. Is there anything worse as a parent of kids who are both disobedient and unthankful? My wife is laughing. We've had these conversations. Again, it's a reflection of the heart. Reminds us in Romans 3 that we're all like this, right? There's none of us who are righteous. No, not one. No one understands. No one seeks God. All turned aside, become worthless. No one does good, not even one. And while we say, hey, I'm not all these things, you know what? Our heart is represented in this as well. And we see the world, as my mother-in-law would say, going the pot, going being crazy. It's remind us that in ourselves, we all have this selfishness. We're all self-centered. We're all sinners. And while the world is going crazy, there is a better way. Give us Jesus. That in the midst of this, in the midst of our heart being represented in these things, God so loved you. Not because you were good, or not because you were perfect, or not because you lived in Pennsylvania. No, there's none of us righteous. No, not one. None of us seek after God. But God loves you even when you shake your fist at him. And he so loved you, he sent Jesus. He came and he lived, and Christ died for you to offer you forgiveness and a better way. They may have this world, the better way is found through Christ. And if you would believe in him, you don't have to perish. You can have everlasting life. But in the last days, in these terrible days, this is how our society is going to act. And you see a buildup from people who are disobedient to parents, to people who are unthankful. In the next verse, I love how it says that people will be lacking in self-control. That sounds like today, doesn't it? Lacking in self-control. The average person looks at their phone somewhere between 60 and 100 times an hour. They'll be fierce and hate the good. Next week we'll go in verse 13. Evil men and imposters will go from bad to worse, deceiving and being deceived. You can have the world. There's something better. Give us Jesus. Verse 4, there'll be traitors, not just to the country. There's the same word used of Judas, right? That will turn our back on the people that we're close with. Be headstrong, haughty. Be lovers of pleasure rather than lovers of God. Right? There's this build-up. There's this climax. Lovers of self, lovers of pleasures. Verse 5, they'll have this appearance of godly, but there'll be people who turn others away from God. Having this form of godliness, denying its power, turn such people away. We'll be religious, but not seek Jesus. We'll be moral, but be farther away from God. Right? Seems like the world around us, doesn't it? If you're following along, second point, making bad choices leading astray. This is a hard verse. I'm going to read through it and hopefully break it down in a way that you understand. For these sorts of people will creep into households, make captives of gullible women, loaded down with sins, led astray by various lusts. The word that jumps out to me might be the word that jumps out to you is gullible. What this verse is not saying is that men are smarter than women, or men are up here, or women are down here. Not what it's saying. The idea of being gullible is that you should know better. For example, you ever have a little kid go point at your shirt and go, "Hey, you got something on your shirt." Now, after the fifth time, you should know that really you don't have anything on your shirt. But every once in a while, you'll go like this, and what will they do? They'll flick you in the eye. By the way, one of the more annoying things in the world is to get flicked in the eye, right? And you get mad at them because they got you. But in a sense, who should you really be mad at? Yourself, right? Because you knew there wasn't. And by the way, some of you will play along for your grandkids' sake. God bless you. You're better grandparents than I am. Or better parents than I am. But there's like, hey, I knew better, but what did I do? I went like this anyway. So what is this really saying? I think Paul is talking to the church. I think he's talking to the people who grew up in the church, people who knew the teachings of God. And instead of having that be their bedrock, they made bad decisions and they fell in love with the wrong person. And they got married, and they have these unyoked or uneven relationships. By the way, we all know people who have married the wrong person, haven't we? Nod your head if you have a family member, maybe a son or a daughter. You're like, you know, I try to warn them about this guy. I tried to, you know, he was no good for her, but you know what? Her heart, and she was in love with him, and she gave her heart, and they walked down the aisle. And it ended up being heartbreaking. Because instead of that person drawing them closer to the Lord, now they're farther and farther and farther away from God. Nod your head if you know someone who fell in love with the wrong person. Right? They grew up in church. They heard the Bible. They knew the scriptures. But their heart was drawn to the wrong person. And now your grandkids are far from the Lord. By the way, there's people here in our church. They grew up in youth group. They went to our Sunday schools, and they fell in love. They married the wrong person, and they've given their heart to the wrong thing. So these people, they creep in, and they load these women down with sins. They lead them astray from the things of God. Love the last phrase there, that they are led astray by their various lusts. So the idea is their passions lead them away from Jesus. So in 2023, we don't have a problem with passion, right? In some ways, our world is more passionate about the things of the world than ever before. I'll prove it to you. How many of you are excited for another presidential election next year? Anybody? Anybody like, yes, you know what? This is going to be great. Couple things. Every presidential election in modern history has spent more money than the election before. Right? Passion. We're going to have people give more money for a candidate or party than ever before. We're going to see these people on TV more than ever before. How many of you are excited to get the mailers and to see the ads and to have the pop-ups on your YouTube videos? We're passionate, aren't we? We're going to have signs. And we're going to have TV programs. We're going to see debates. And not only will we see debates, we'll have cable news running like 24/7 on one side of the aisle or the other. And sadly, in the past, our passion has caused friendships to end. And our passion has caused families to split. Right? It's not that we lack passion. It's as we give our hearts to these things. Read with me the next verse. That led us astray by their various lusts, learning and never able to come to the knowledge of the truth. We know more now than we've ever known. Right? Does it make us any more like Jesus? Passions lead us away from Jesus. I mean, we don't lack passion. I mean, right now we're in sports season. And sports never really has an off season, does it? I mean, we've never been more passionate. Here's the craziest thing about sports. Ready? Network TV, over the last 20 years, ratings have gone like this. Right? Some of you remember the days where you had like five channels and you had to watch TV live and ratings were up here. And now live TV ratings are down here, except in sports. Sports is the only program that ratings have actually crept up in the last 20 years. For example, what is the most watched program every year, basically, of the last 20 years? It's the Super Bowl. 100 million people watched the Super Bowl last year, approximately. You have sports, right? It used to be that you'd paint your face, you'd go to the game, and you'd think about it in another week. Now we have cable programs. We have podcasts. And to make the passion even a little bit more, we have sports betting. Right? We have the internet. We know facts and statistics, and we follow these things, and we have fantasy sports about these things, and we bet on these things, and we have more and more knowledge of these things that our passions, our lusts, our desires have never been stronger. But these things lead us away from Jesus, right? As the hymn says, you know, you may have this world, but give me Jesus. And as you look at your own heart, are you giving your heart to the wrong things? To lesser things? You know what? Your life has never been busier, but you've never seen farther away from God. You've never had more items in your collection, but you never felt as empty and far away from God. Your bank account can grow and your love for God can decrease. You can know more things about the political scene, the candidates. You can know all the stats for your favorite sports team. And these things can consume you and become your life. It's not that we don't lack passion. It's not that we don't gain information, but we gain these things of the world, and it actually pushes us farther and farther away from God. It's interesting. As the heart of the world has gotten crazier and crazier, it has also become more and more empty. The other thing that's happened in the last 20 to 30 years is things like mental health has become an all-time high, suicide rates, counseling rates, all these things that show the emptiness of our society keep going like this, and yet keeps pushing the things of the Lord farther and farther away. And by the way, at this point, I'm not just talking out there. At this point, I'm also talking about in the church. Because you can know the things of God, and you can listen to the messages, and yet you can still give your heart to lesser things. You can, in fact, at times be the gullible one, where you should know better, and your heart is turned away by the things of this world. You know, they can have the world. Our heart should be focused on Jesus. Got one final point as we go through this passage. This one's an interesting one. Verses 8 and 9, if you're here with me, it says, "Now Jannes and Jambres resisted Moses, did these things to resist the truth." Some of you who are Bible scholars might be like, "Huh, who are these people? These are the only time these people's names are mentioned in the Bible." Hillel was called the elder. He's the founder of the Pharisee movement in the time of Jesus. In his writings, he identifies these two, he gives them names, and he says these two are the two magicians who opposed Moses in the book of Exodus. So if you don't remember the story, you might remember the movie. Moses says, "Let my people go." And Pharaoh says, "No, thank you. I got a no. Appreciate that." At first, Moses grabs a staff and he throws it on the ground, and the staff becomes a snake or a serpent. And these two, one the juggler, one the magician, they threw down their serpents, and what happens? They become snakes. Now, Moses eats them up, which is kind of weird, but a few verses later, when Moses appears to Pharaoh and turns the water into blood, it says, through their secret arts, these two were able to do the same. When Moses produced the frogs, they were able to do the same. But eventually, when you get to the sixth plague, it says the magicians, again, these two guys, could not stand before Moses because of the boils. So the boils came upon the magicians and upon the magicians and all the Egyptians. But the Lord hardened the heart of Pharaoh. He did not listen to them. The Lord had spoken to Moses. So you see here, Jannes and Jambres, they resisted Moses. So these also resist the truth. Men of corrupt minds, disapproving of the faith. And they will progress no further, for their folly will manifest to all, and theirs also was. So the idea is Pharaoh was presented with the truth. And for a time, these two characters could turn Pharaoh's hearts away. Right? Through the serpent, through the blood, through the frogs. But eventually the truth came out. And even though the truth came out, what does it say about Pharaoh's heart? It says that the Lord hardened the heart of Pharaoh. And he's turned away from the things of God, and he continues to chase after his own things. They may have the world, give me Jesus. Sometimes we give our hearts to lesser things, and it distracts us, and it takes us away from the things of God. Eventually, we find out those things are shallow, right? We can have 100 pieces in our collection, and we still long after the 101st. We're still chasing that. We can win 5 bets in a row, and we still are chasing the 6th and the 7th. We can have 12 hours of watching cable news, and we come back day after day, and we think that there's going to be hope in our next political candidate. And we're going to elect someone. We're going to get all excited. You know what's going to happen? We're going to realize that our hope isn't in the politics. Our hope isn't in Harrisburg. It's in heaven. And it's going to leave us empty, and we're going to be like Pharaoh, keep chasing after the things of this world. Keep chasing after the next league. Keep chasing after the next paycheck. Keep chasing after the next overtime. Keep chasing after the next adventure. Keep chasing, keep chasing, keep chasing. And we can never have more passion and more knowledge, and it leads us further and further and further from the things of God. You know, you can have this world and all the things of it, and the only thing that's going to bring you satisfaction are the things of Christ. Because God formed you, and he knows you, and he offers you hope and forgiveness through Jesus. I say all that to ask you, have you ever trusted in Jesus as your Savior? You can just look in your life this week and all these people chasing all these worthless things. And they're chasing and they're chasing and they make you think, oh, it's so great. But in the end, it satisfies for a small time and it leaves you empty and it leaves you wanting more and it leaves you chasing the next thing. God has a better plan for you. Admit that your heart is sinful and trust in Jesus as your Savior. And secondly, are you giving your heart to the wrong thing? There's 19 in the list, and I bet Paul would say this is probably not even a comprehensive list. And I gave a bunch of illustrations, and maybe some of them touched your heart, and maybe some of them didn't touch your heart. But God right now might be, you know, nudging you or beating in you and saying, look, this is you. You're chasing after the wrong things, and you know where this is going to lead. Maybe today God is calling you to chase after the things of Him. Look, if you're chasing after the wrong thing, the idea is you're going this way, you need to stop, turn around, and align your heart with the things of God. Look, they may have the world, focus on the things of Jesus. Let's pray together. Father, we're so thankful that you loved us, that you gave us your Son. God, we're prone to wander, Lord. We're prone to give our hearts to lesser things, Lord. We're prone to get caught up, Lord. We're prone to dabble from the path that you have for us. God, I pray that you would be working in our hearts and our souls even now, that through your Spirit, you're convicting us. Lord, you're prompting in us. Lord, give us the faith to follow after you, to trust you, even when it's hard, even when my friends or my coworkers or my family are going down this path. Lord, help me to seek the things you'd have me to seek. Lord, that they may have the world, Lord, give us Jesus. It's in Christ we pray. Amen. Hey, we're going to stand and sing Lean on the Everlasting Arms.
Peace.
Let's pray, and we'll be dismissed. Father, we just thank you for your love, your consideration of our needs. Father, let us look at our own hearts this morning. And God, allow us to take stock of where we really are. Father, allow us to examine, and Lord, allow us to see where we should lean on you more, where we are going adrift, Lord, where we stray, where we're chasing after things that are just leaving us empty. God, help us to seek you first and to seek you foremost. And God, help us to seek you with all of our heart, soul, mind, and strength. So it's in Jesus we ask. Amen.